This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Expedition of Humphry Clinker. Author: Tobias Smollett. Topic: To Mr. Henry Davis, bookseller in London. Topic: Abergavenny, August 4th. Topic: Respected Sir, I have received your esteemed favor of the 13th ultimo, whereby it appeareth that you have perused those same letters, the which were delivered unto you by my friend, the Reverend Mr. Hugo Ben, and I am pleased to find you think they may be printed with a good prospect of success, inasmuch as the objections you mention, I humbly conceive, are such as may be red-argued, if not entirely removed, and first in the first place, as touching what prosecutions may arise from printing the private correspondence of persons still living, give me leave, with all due submission, to observe that the letters in question were not written and sent under the seal of secrecy, that they have no tendency to the mala fama or prejudice of any person whatsoever, but rather to the information and edification of mankind, so that it becometh a sort of duty to promulgate them in usum publicum. Besides, I have consulted Mr. Davy Higgins, an eminent attorney of this place, who, after due inspection and consideration, declareth that he doth not think the said letters contain any matter which will be held actionable in the eye of the law. Finally, if you and I should come to a right understanding, I do declare in verbo sacerdotis that in case of any such prosecution, I will take the whole upon my own shoulders, even quod fine and imprisonment, though I must confess I should not care to undergo flagellation, tam ad turpitudinem, quam ad ameritudinem poenoi spectans. Secondly, concerning the personal resentment of Mr. Justice Lismahago, I may say, non floci facio, I would not willingly vilipend any Christian if, peradventure, he deserveth that epithet, albeit I am much surprised that more care is not taken to exclude from the commission all such vagrant foreigners as may be justly suspected of disaffection to our happy constitution in church and state. God forbid that I should be so uncharitable as to affirm positively that the said Lismahago is no better than a Jesuit in disguise. But this I will assert and maintain, totus viribus, that from the day he qualified, he has never been once seen intra templi parietes, that is to say, within the parish church. Thirdly, with respect to what passed at Mr. Kendall's table, when the said Lismahago was so brutal in his reprehensions, I must inform you, my good sir, that I was obliged to retire, not by fear arising from his minatory reproaches, which, as I said above, I value not of a rush, but from the sudden effect produced by a barbel's row which I had eaten at dinner, not knowing that the said row is at certain seasons violently cathartic, as Galen observeth in his chapter Peri Ictos. Fourthly and lastly, with reference to the manner in which I got possession of these letters, it is a circumstance that concerns my own conscience only. Suffice it to say, I have fully satisfied the parties in whose custody they were, and by this time I hope I have also satisfied you in such ways that the last hand may be put to our agreement, and the work proceed with all convenient expedition, in which I hope I rest. Respected Sir, your very humble servant, Jonathan Dustwich. P.S. I propose, Deo volente, to have the pleasure of seeing you in the great city, towards All Hallowtide, when I shall be glad to treat with you concerning a parcel of MS sermons of a certain clergyman deceased, a cake of the right leaven for the present taste of the public. Verbum sapienti in C. J.D. Topic: To the Rev. Mr. Jonathan Dustwich, at Topic: Sir, I received yours in course of post, and shall be glad to treat with you for the MS which I have delivered to your friend Mr. Ben, but can by no means comply with the terms proposed. Those things are so uncertain, writing is all a lottery. I have been a loser by the works of the greatest men of the age. I could mention particulars and name names, but don't choose it, the taste of the town is so changeable. Then there have been so many letters upon travels lately published. What between Smollett's, Sharp's, Derrick's, Thicknesses, Baltimore's, and Baretti's, together with Shandy, as sentimental travels, the public seems to be cloyed with that kind of entertainment. Nevertheless, I will, if you please, run the risque of printing and publishing, and you shall have half the profits of the impression. You need not take the trouble to bring up your sermons on my account. Nobody reads sermons but Methodists and dissenters. Besides, for my own part, I am quite a stranger to that sort of reading, and the two persons whose judgment I depended upon in those matters are out of the way. One is gone abroad, carpenter of a man of war, and the other has been silly enough to abscond, in order to avoid a prosecution for blasphemy. I'm a great loser by his going off. He has left a manual of devotion, half finished on my hands, after having received money for the whole copy. He was the soundest divine, and had the most orthodox pen of all my people, and I never knew his judgment fail, but in flying from his bread and butter on this occasion. By owning you was not put in bodily fear by Lismahago, you preclude yourself from the benefit of a good plea, over and above the advantage of binding him over. In the late war, I inserted in my evening paper a paragraph that came by the post, reflecting upon the behavior of a certain regiment in battle. An officer of said regiment came to my shop, and in the presence of my wife and journeyman, threatened to cut off my ears, as I exhibited marks of bodily fear more ways than one, to the conviction of the bystanders. I bound him over, my action lay and I recovered. As for flagellation, you have nothing to fear, and nothing to hope on that head. There has been but one printer flogged at the cart's tail these 30 years, that was Charles Watson, and he assured me it was no more than a flea bite. C.S. has been threatened several times by the House of L., but it came to nothing. If an information should be moved for, and granted against you as the editor of those letters, I hope you will have honesty and wit enough to appear and take your trial. If you should be sentenced to the pillory, your fortune is made. As times go, that's a sure step to honor and preferment. I shall think myself happy if I can lend you a lift, and am very sincerely. Yours, Henry Davis. London, August 10th. Please my kind service to your neighbor, my cousin Maddock. I have sent an almanac and court calendar, directed for him at Mr. Sutton's bookseller in Gloucester, carriage paid, which he will please to accept as a small token of my regard. My wife, who is very fond of toasted cheese, presents her compliments to him, and begs to know if there's any of that kind, which he was so good as to send us last Christmas to be sold in London. H.D. Topic: The Expedition of Humphry Clinker. Topic: To Dr. Lewis. Topic: Doctor. The pills are good for nothing. I might as well swallow snowballs to cool my reins. I have told you over and over how hard I am to move, and at this time of day I ought to know something of my own constitution. Why will you be so positive? Prithee send me another prescription. I am as lame and as much tortured in all my limbs as if I was broke upon the wheel. Indeed, I am equally distressed in mind and body, as if I had not plagues enough of my own. Those children of my sister are left me for a perpetual source of vexation. What business have people to get children to plague their neighbors? A ridiculous incident that happened yesterday to my niece Lydia has disordered me in such a manner that I expect to be laid up with another fit of the gout. Perhaps I may explain myself in my next. I shall set out tomorrow morning for the Hot Well at Bristol, where I am afraid I shall stay longer than I could wish. On the receipt of this, send Williams thither with my saddle horse and the demi-pique. Tell Barnes to thresh out the two old ricks, and send the corn to market, and sell it off to the poor at a shilling a bushel under market price. I have received a sniveling letter from Griffin, offering to make a public submission and pay costs. I want none of his submissions, neither will I pocket any of his money. The fellow is a bad neighbor, and I desire to have nothing to do with him. But as he is purse proud, he shall pay for his insolence. Let him give £5 to the poor of the parish, and I will withdraw my action, and in the meantime you may tell Prigg to stop proceedings. Let Morgan's widow have the Alderney cow, and 40 shillings to clothe her children. But don't say a syllable of the matter to any living soul, I'll make her pay when she is able. I desire you will lock up all my drawers, and keep the keys till meeting, and be sure you take the iron chest with my papers into your own custody. Forgive all this trouble from. Dear Lewis, Your affectionate M. Bramble, Gloucester, April 2nd. Topic: To Mrs. Gwyllim, housekeeper at Brambleton-Hall. Topic: Mrs. Gwyllim. When this comes to hand, be sure to pack up in the trunk mail that stands in my closet. To be sent me in the Bristol wagon without loss of time the following articles, viz. My rose-collared neglihi with green robins, my yellow damask, and my black velvets with the short hoop. My blue quilted petticoat, my green mantle, my laced apron, my French commode, Macklin head and lappets, and the lattel box with my jowls. Williams may bring over my bum de fee, and the vial with the easings of Dr. Hill's dockwater and Chowder's laxative. The poor creature has been terribly stuprated ever since we left Hewam. Pray take particular care of the house while the family is absent. Let there be a fire constantly kept in my brother's chamber and mine. The maids, having nothing to do, may be sat a-spinning. I desire you'll clap a padlock on the wind cellar, and let none of the men have access to the strong bear. Don't forget to have the gate shit every evening be dark. The gardener and the hind may lie below in the landry to partake the house with the blunderbuss and the great dog, and hope you'll have a watchful eye over the maids. I know that hussy Mary Jones loves to be rumping with the men. Let me know Alderney's calf be sold yet, and what he fought, if the old goose be sitting, and if the cobbler has cut Dickie, and how poor Animal bore the operation. No more at present, but rests. Yours, Tabitha Bramble, Gloucester, April 2nd. To Mrs. Mary Jones at Brambleton Hall. Dear Molly, heaving this importunity, I send my love to you and Saul, being in good health, and hoping to hear the same from you, and that you and Saul will take my poor kitten to bed with you this cold weather. We have been all in a sad taking here at Gloucester. Miss Lydia had like to have run away with a player man and young master, and he would have done themselves a mischief. But the squire applied to the mayor, and they were bound over. Mistress bid me not speak a word of the matter to any Christian soul, no more I shall, for we servants should see all and say nothing. But what was worse than all this, Chowder has had the misfortune to be worried by a butcher's dog and came home in a terrible pickle. Mistress was taken with the asterisks, but they soon went off. The doctor was sent for to Chowder, and he subscribed a repository which did him great service. Thank God he's now in a fair way to do well. Pray take care of my box and the pilly bear and put them under your own bed, for I do suppose, madam, Gwyllim will be a prying into my secrets now my back is turned. John Thomas is in good health, but sulky. The squire gave away an old coat to a poor man, and John says as how 'tis robbing him of his perquisites. I told him by his agreement he was to receive no veils, but he says as how there's a difference betwixt veils and perquisites, and so there is for sartain. We are all going to the hot well, where I shall drink your health in a glass of water, being, dear Molly, your humble servant to command, W. Jenkins, Gloucester, April 2nd. Topic: To Sir Watkin Phillips, Bart. Of Jesus College, Oxon. Topic: Dear Phillips, as I have nothing more at heart than to convince you I am incapable of forgetting or neglecting the friendship I made at college, now begin that correspondence by letters which you and I agreed at parting to cultivate. I begin it sooner than I intended, that you may have it in your power to refute any idle reports which may be circulated to my prejudice at Oxford, touching a foolish quarrel in which I have been involved on account of my sister, who had been some time settled here in a boarding school. When I came hither with my uncle and aunt, who are our guardians, to fetch her away, I found her a fine tall girl of 17, with an agreeable person, but remarkably simple and quite ignorant of the world. This disposition and want of experience had exposed her to the addresses of a person, I know not what to call him, who had seen her at a play, and with a confidence and dexterity peculiar to himself, found means to be recommended to her acquaintance. It was by the greatest accident I intercepted one of his letters. As it was my duty to stifle this correspondence in its birth, I made it my business to find him out and tell him very freely my sentiments of the matter. The spark did not like the style I used, and behaved with abundance of metal. Though his rank in life, which, by the by, I am ashamed to declare, did not entitle him to much deference. Yet as his behavior was remarkably spirited, I admitted him to the privilege of a gentleman, and something might have happened, had not we been prevented. In short, the business took air, I know not how, and made abundance of noise, recourse was had to justice. I was obliged to give my word and honor and see, and tomorrow morning we set out for Bristol Wells, where I expect to hear from you by the return of the post. I have got into a family of originals, whom I may one day attempt to describe for your amusement. My aunt, Mrs. Tabitha Bramble, is a maiden of 45, exceedingly starched, vain, and ridiculous. My uncle is an odd kind of humorist, always on the fret, and so unpleasant in his manner, that rather than be obliged to keep him company, I'd resign all claim to the inheritance of his estate. Indeed, his being tortured by the gout may have soured his temper, and perhaps I may like him better on further acquaintance. Certain it is, all his servants and neighbors in the country are fond of him, even to a degree of enthusiasm, the reason of which I cannot as yet comprehend. Remember me to Griffey Price, Gwyn, Mansell Bassett, and all the rest of my old Cambrian companions. Salute the bedmaker in my name. Give my service to the cook, and pray take care of poor Ponto for the sake of his old master who is and ever will be. Dear Phillips, your affectionate friend and humble servant Jer. Melford, Gloucester, April 2nd. Topic: To Mrs. JERMYN at her house in Gloucester. Topic: Dear Madam, having no mother of my own, I hope you will give me leave to disburden my poor heart to you, who have always acted the part of a kind parent to me, ever since I was put under your care. Indeed, and indeed my worthy governess may believe me, when I assure her that I never harbored a thought that was otherwise than virtuous. And if God will give me grace, I shall never behave so as to cast a reflection on the care you have taken in my education. I confess I have given just cause of offense by my want of prudence and experience. I ought not to have listened to what the young man said, and it was my duty to have told you all that passed, but I was ashamed to mention it, and then he behaved so modest and respectful, and seemed to be so melancholy and timorous, that I could not find in my heart to do anything that should make him miserable and desperate. As for familiarities, I do declare, I never once allowed him the favor of a salute, and as to the few letters that pass between us, they are all in my uncle's hands, and I hope they contain nothing contrary to innocence and honor. I am still persuaded that he is not what he appears to be, but time will discover. Meanwhile, I will endeavor to forget a connection which is so displeasing to my family. I have cried without ceasing, and have not tasted anything but tea since I was hurried away from you. Nor did I once close my eyes for 3 nights running. My aunt continues to chide me severely when we are by ourselves, but I hope to soften her in time by humility and submission. My uncle, who was so dreadfully passionate in the beginning, has been moved by my tears and distress, and is now all tenderness and compassion, and my brother is reconciled to me on my promise to break off all correspondence with that unfortunate youth. But notwithstanding all their indulgence, I shall have no peace of mind till I know my dear and ever-honored governess has forgiven her poor, disconsolate, forlorn. Affectionate humble servant, till death, Lydia Melford Clifton, April 6th. Topic: To Miss LAETITIA WILLIS at Gloucester. Topic: My dearest Letty, I am in such a fright, lest this should not come safe to hand by the conveyance of Jarvis the carrier, that I beg you will write me on the receipt of it, directing to me under cover, to Mrs. Winifred Jenkins, my aunt's maid, who is a good girl, and has been so kind to me in my affliction, that I have made her my confidant. As for Jarvis, he was very shy of taking charge of my letter and the little parcel, because his sister Sally had liked to have lost her place on my account. Indeed, I cannot blame the man for his caution, but I have made it worth his while. My dear companion and bedfellow, it is a grievous addition to my other misfortunes that I am deprived of your agreeable company and conversation, at a time when I need so much the comfort of your good humor and good sense. But I hope the friendship we contracted at boarding school will last for life. I doubt not, but on my side it will daily increase and improve, as I gain experience and learn to know the value of a true friend. Oh, my dear Letty, what shall I say about poor Mr. Wilson? I have promised to break off all correspondence and, if possible, to forget him. But alas! I begin to perceive that will not be in my power. As it is by no means proper that the picture should remain in my hands, lest it should be the occasion of more mischief, I have sent it to you by this opportunity, begging you will either keep it safe till better times, or return it to Mr. Wilson himself, who, I suppose, will make it his business to see you at the usual place. If he should be low-spirited at my sending back his picture, you may tell him I have no occasion for a picture while the original continues engraved on my. But no, I would not have you tell him that neither, because there must be an end of our correspondence. I wish he may forget me, for the sake of his own peace. And yet if he should, he must be a barbarous. But it is impossible. Poor Wilson cannot be false and inconstant. I beseech him not to write to me, nor attempt to see me for some time. For, considering the resentment and passionate temper of my brother Jerry, such an attempt might be attended with consequences which would make us all miserable for life. Let us trust to time and the chapter of accidents, or rather to that providence which will not fail sooner or later, to reward those that walk in the paths of honor and virtue. I would offer my love to the young ladies, but it is not fit that any of them should know you have received this letter. If we go to Bath, I shall send you my simple remarks upon that famous center of polite amusement, and every other place we may chance to visit. And I flatter myself that my dear Miss Willis will be punctual in answering the letters of her affectionate. Lydia Melford Clifton, April 6. Topic: to Dr. Lewis. Topic: dear Lewis. I have followed your directions with some success, and might have been upon my legs by this time, had the weather permitted me to use my saddle horse. I rode out upon the downs last Tuesday, in the forenoon, when the sky, as far as the visible horizon, was without a cloud, but before I had gone a full mile, I was overtaken instantaneously by a storm of rain that wet me to the skin in 3 minutes. Whence it came, the devil knows, but it has laid me up, I suppose, for one fortnight. It makes me sick to hear people talk of the fine air upon Clifton Downs. How can the air be either agreeable or salutary, where the demon of vapors descends in a perpetual drizzle? My confinement is the more intolerable, as I am surrounded with domestic vexations. My niece has had a dangerous fit of illness, occasioned by that cursed incident at Gloucester, which I mentioned in my last. She is a poor good-natured simpleton, as soft as butter, and is easily melted, not that she's a fool. The girl's parts are not despicable, and her education has not been neglected. That is to say, she can write and spell and speak French and play upon the harpsichord. Then she dances finely, has a good figure, and is very well inclined, but she, as deficient in spirit, and so susceptible, and so tender forsooth. Truly, she has got a languishing eye and reads romances. Then there's her brother Squire Jerry, a pert jackanapes, full of college petulance and self-conceit, proud as a German count and as hot and hasty as a Welsh mountaineer. As for that fantastical animal, my sister Tabby, you are no stranger to her qualifications. I vow to God she is sometimes so intolerable that I almost think she's the devil incarnate come to torment me for my sins, and yet I am conscious of no sins that ought to entail such family plagues upon me. Why the devil should not I shake off these torments at once? I ain't married to Tabby, thank heaven, nor did I beget the other two. Let them choose another guardian. For my part, one ain't in a condition to take care of myself, much less to superintend the conduct of giddy-headed boys and girls. You earnestly desire to know the particulars of our adventure at Gloucester, which are briefly these, and I hope they will go no further. Liddy had been so long copped up in a boarding school, which, next to a nunnery, is the worst kind of seminary that ever was contrived for young women, that she became as inflammable as touch wood, and going to a play in holiday time, Esteth, I'm ashamed to tell you, she fell in love with one of the actors, a handsome young fellow that goes by the name of Wilson. The rascal soon perceived the impression he had made, and managed matters so as to see her at a house where she went to drink tea with her governess. This was the beginning of a correspondence, which they kept up by means of a jade of a milliner, who made and dressed caps for the girls at the boarding school. When we arrived at Gloucester, Liddy came to stay at lodgings with her aunt, and Wilson bribed the maid to deliver a letter into her own hands. But it seems Jerry had already acquired so much credit with the maid, by what means he best knows, that she carried the letter to him, and so the whole plot was discovered. The rash boy, without saying a word of the matter to me, went immediately in search of Wilson, and I suppose treated him with insolence enough. The theatrical hero was too far gone in romance to brook such usage. He replied in blank verse, and a formal challenge ensued. They agreed to meet early next morning, and decide the dispute with sword and pistol. I heard nothing at all of the affair, till Mr. Morley came to my bedside in the morning, and told me he was afraid my nephew was going to fight, as he had been overheard talking very loud and vehement with Wilson at the young man's lodgings the night before, and afterwards went and bought powder and ball at a shop in the neighborhood. I got up immediately, and upon inquiry found he was just going out. I begged Morley to knock up the mayor, that he might interpose as a magistrate, and in the meantime I hobbled after the squire, whom I saw at a distance walking at a great pace towards the city gate. In spite of all my efforts, I could not come up till our two combatants had taken their ground and were priming their pistols. An old house luckily screened me from their view, so that I rushed upon them at once before I was perceived. They were both confounded, and attempted to make their escape different ways, but Morley coming up with constables at that instant took Wilson into custody, and Jerry followed him quietly to the mayor's house. All this time I was ignorant of what had passed the preceding day, and neither of the parties would discover a tittle of the matter. The mayor observed that it was great presumption in Wilson, who was a stroller, to proceed to such extremities with a gentleman of family and fortune, and threatened to commit him on the vagrant act. The young fellow bustled up with great spirit, declaring he was a gentleman and would be treated as such, but he refused to explain himself further. The master of the company being sent for and examined, touching the said Wilson, said the young man had engaged with him at Birmingham about 6 months ago, but never would take his salary, that he had behaved so well in his private character as to acquire the respect and goodwill of all his acquaintance, and that the public owned his merit as an actor was altogether extraordinary. After all, I fancy he will turn out to be a runaway prentice from London. The manager offered to bail him for any sum, provided he would give his word and honor that he would keep the peace. But the young gentleman was on his high ropes, and would by no means lay himself under any restrictions. On the other hand, Hopeful was equally obstinate, till at length the mayor declared that if they both refused to be bound over, he would immediately commit Wilson as a vagrant to hard labor. I own I was much pleased with Jerry's behavior on this occasion. He said that rather than Mr. Wilson should be treated in such an ignominious manner, he would give his word and honor to prosecute the affair no further while they remained at Gloucester. Wilson thanked him for his generous manner of proceeding, and was discharged. On our return to our lodgings, my nephew explained the whole mystery, and I own I was exceedingly incensed. Liddy being questioned on the subject, and very severely reproached by that wildcat my sister Tabby, first swooned away, then dissolving in a flood of tears, confessed all the particulars of the correspondence, at the same time giving up three letters, which was all she had received from her admirer. The last, which Jerry intercepted, I send you enclosed, and when you have read it, I dare say you won't wonder at the progress the writer had made in the heart of a simple girl, utterly unacquainted with the characters of mankind. Thinking it was high time to remove her from such a dangerous connection, I carried her off the very next day to Bristol. But the poor creature was so frightened and fluttered by our threats and expostulations that she fell sick the fourth day after our arrival at Clifton, and continued so ill for a whole week that her life was despaired of. It was not till yesterday that Dr. Rigg declared her out of danger. You cannot imagine what I have suffered, partly from the indiscretion of this poor child, but much more from the fear of losing her entirely. This air is intolerably cold, and the place quite solitary. I never go down to the well without returning low-spirited, for there I meet with half a dozen poor emaciated creatures with ghostly looks in the last stage of a consumption, who have made shift to linger through the winter like so many exotic plants languishing in a hothouse, but in all appearance, will drop into their graves before the sun has warmth enough to mitigate the rigor of this ungenial spring. If you think the bath water will be of any service to me, I will go thither so soon as my niece can bear the motion of the coach. Tell Barnes I am obliged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.